And this is largely the idea that you can catch as far as Singapore is concerned. We are a dense shared space, right? Cosmopolitan, one of the most globalized countries in the world. And in doing so over here, we have to get a better grasp, right, over what's really happening first. Okay? Don't see how in this particular room you've got, I don't know, your standard CIMO, Chinese, Indian, Malay, and others, right? And therefore, you know, our frameworks. We get this way. The CIMO framework no longer works anymore. That mental model just doesn't support it. Right? But we don't know what else to call it. Right? And our top-down approaches are weakening. Right, this way. So in doing so, what then do we need to do? So let's take a look at this. So, do you mind if I just share my stories? Is this okay? It's okay. Okay, then we can plug in and get it right. So, I'm going to share a story over here, and I think it will help us better understand what we mean by finding common space, right, or finding a particular trust. So the question I'm asking is, where in all complexity do we find common space? Where does it come from? What does it emerge from? Where do we come from? Okay. So, let me check. When I first began teaching, this is many years ago, there was one particular class for me that was a transformative class. Their experience that they gave to me was one that convinced me to do the work that I do today. Like, this class was called S5B, it's a science class. Probably not important, but it's important to me, okay? So S5B came to place with 17 people in this particular class. Right? Of the 17 people, 15 were girls and 2 were boys. Okay? It's not typical of a science class. Okay? 15 girls, 2 boys. Of the 15 girls over there, 12 of the girls happened to be the hottest girls in school. Okay? How this happened by some alignment of stars in the universe, I have no idea. But they were all together. Right? When they left class and they walked in canteen, everybody felt it. You watch enough movies to get curious. So they weren't mean girls, but they all came together and clicked because they were classmates. They won't hang out together because they were all beautiful. Right? It's like I said, it's just some alignment of stars. Okay? The two boys, there was one particular boy who every day, he was my height. Right? He was my height. And he was about half my weight, gangly boy. Okay? And he had acne all over his face. Right. He would come into school with a big school bag, and the school bag would be up to here. All of them with notes. And he'd be carrying 2 NTUC plastic bags full of notes. Okay? And he'll carry his NTUC plastic bags full of notes, and he'll run, right, sweating, having singing out. Right? But every time he stood, I noticed this, during flag raising and during national anthem, he would not let go of the plastic bags. And he'd keep holding them. Right? So if he came to class, what he would do is this. A chair would be here. Like a class, so he'll come from the back. And then he will take the chair. And he brings it into the corner. And then he sits here, facing the wall. And I will be teaching here. And he's in the corner. He's not autistic. Right? He's one of the best performing students I have. Right? His kind of stuff will always be silent. And he'll ask me questions privately outside. Right? But he will do this on a daily basis. So who would be the one to do this behavior? At a point in time, I don't think I was experienced enough to intervene. Let's go. Okay, as long as you're doing well. Enjoy. No, I'm not doing. And if you're going and do this, right? And the rest of the class learned to tolerate him. Right? Then in year 2, somewhere in February, he had come to me and he whispered, and says, Mr. Tom, can I talk to you? Right? I go, sure. And says, not here. There's a library. I said, okay. So we're not in the library. We then began to talk, and he said, I have a very big problem. I fantasize about the girls every day. And I masturbate about them every day. And I'm damn scared, really, really scared I will touch them. And if I let go of these plastic bags, if my hands are empty, I don't know what I'll do. And he says, I will grip and I'll hold on to them every day so that I don't harm anybody else. Right? But I'm very scared. I kept it a secret, I can't keep it anymore. Could you please help me? And I said, sure. And we then began to talk. And for the next 2 months, we then began to talk. Now every day the same behavior would be there. He would carry plastic bags, he would walk in, and sit down. Then one day, I was teaching, and then the class in front of me goes. I turned around, and he had his hand raised. It was the first. So I go, yes. What's up? And he stands up, turns around, and says, I have something to say. going, what? And he looks at the class and says, I masturbate about all of you every day. Then he told the class. And then there was silence. I thought I was going to be fired. I said, oh, yes. I have no idea what I'm going to do. And then what happened is one girl stood up. And she looked at him. She said, it's okay. All the boys must have been us. But it is you there to admit it. And then she comes up and she walks to the front. And she takes his hand and says, and she held his hand, and she went to the third row, and she opened up a seat for him. And she says, next time, you will sit here next to me, and you will be safe. The girls around, and the other ones, you must understand the diversity of reactions, by the way. Right? Before she had intervened, it really was chaos. Right? Oh, I forgot to mention, the other guy in the classroom, he's the tennis captain. Right? And he had to still want to protect these girls, right? I was just trying to keep my job. So over there, it's not like, and so over there, this girl stood up, right? And she created this narrative where he says, hey, it's okay. And when she held his hand brought forward, everybody's body language softened. Right? And she sat down. For the next few days after that, every time he crossed the school gate, three of the girls would be waiting for him. He would take his plastic bags and then bring them over to that girl. They walked with him, right? They hung out with him, they had lunch with him. Like all the other guys in school went, what is he doing? What is he doing? He's going to hang out with me. Right? But to me, that story, and it has still struck me till today, this happened almost 15 years ago. The act of leadership that this girl did found the common space in a very complex and chaotic environment. But she exercised leadership. This young man, then, is now one of the deputy directors in one of the agencies. I truly believe these girls turned his life around. But it's because they didn't feel threat, they didn't close off space, they didn't say, I'm separate from it. Right? So when I asked her many years later, I had a presence of mind to ask her this, so how come you did what you did? And she said a few things. She said, if this happened to me at the time I am right now, and I talked to her, she was already 32. Right? She said, I don't think I'm going to respond to that. I'll protect my children, I'll definitely make sure that we catch the pervert. Right? Because at 18, I actually ironically didn't know better. I didn't have stakes. I had a family that taught me generosity. I had a family that kept me safe, and I did not see danger. So when he raised his hand and said that, other people saw danger, but I didn't. I only saw sincerity because he was trying to do what he did. Right? And he said, she said, I don't think I'm a hero. But my ignorance allowed me to be a leader of one time. And I'm glad that his life is better. Yeah. So they still meet and they talk. But it's something that we can learn a lot from this particular story. But how we find our stories. A lot of it requires us, either through ignorance or not, to drop some of our stories. Or some of our stories.